Hi, I'm Casey. I'm a professor, and many years ago when I applied for PhD programs for the first time, I was rejected from every single one of them. Things obviously worked out okay for me, but it required me to try again. I've done a series of videos here on YouTube about advice for applying for PhD programs. The last one I did was really happy. It was what happens when you have multiple options and have to decide between multiple programs. But some of you might be in the other situation where you don't have options. Maybe you have gotten rejections from the programs that you applied to. First of all, I'm sorry. It sucks. It's demoralizing and it can feel like your journey towards a PhD is over, but that is not necessarily the case. As I talked about in a video with some common reasons why PhD applicants are rejected, some of those reasons have nothing to do with how strong of an applicant you are. Some of it is just bad luck or bad timing, especially when it comes to things like the capacity of departments or even individual advisors. I won't reiterate everything that was in that video, but the gist of it is, it's possible there's nothing wrong with your application. It could just mean that you need to apply again or to apply to a wider variety of programs. But it's also possible that there were some weaknesses in your application that you could strengthen before you try applying again. So that's what I'm going to talk about in this video. So first, you should critically consider your application and whether there are things about the application itself that you can potentially improve. For example, could your statement of purpose be stronger, more tailored? Did you ask the right people to write your letters of recommendation? So I won't detail all the things here that make an application stronger, but you can binge watch my previous videos if you want to. But what I actually really recommend is to get some specific advice from someone in your discipline. Because again, the advice that I give, I try to make it quite general, but it's not going to be perfectly tailored for every discipline. A good place to start might be the faculty who wrote you letters of recommendation. There's a lot of lead time here, so you're not asking for something very quickly. You could write them to thank them again for their help and to let them know that you weren't successful this time, but that you're hoping to apply to programs again. And you're wondering if they might have the bandwidth to give you any advice or even have a look at your statement of purpose. It doesn't hurt to ask. So again, it's possible that your application materials themselves could be improved. It's also possible that they're as good as it can possibly be. And so that's what the rest of this video is going to assume, that it's not a deficiency in the way you put together your application. So the second thing is, for your own credentials, you need to figure out what you can change and what you can't. You know that old cliche about accepting the things that you cannot change and having the wisdom to know the difference? Kind of like that. My advice is to not obsess over the things that you can't change. For example, your GPA at this point may very well be something you cannot change. But remember, your GPA is not going to completely make or break your application. It's just one thing. There also may be some things you may or may not be able to change. For example, GRE scores. And that's one where you really need to weigh the cost-benefit of trying to improve your scores. Whether and how that is going to vary greatly depending on your situation. For example, if you applied to math PhD programs with a very low quant score, it's possible that that was the deciding factor. However, in many cases, it wouldn't have mattered at all, even if GRE scores were required. But in any case, you should focus your efforts on things that you can improve instead of obsessing over the things you can't. And in terms of things you can change between now and applying again later, this is probably the biggest one. Get more experience. Now, what this looks like is going to look really different in different fields. But in general, I think there are three primary flavors in which additional experience comes. The first, get a graduate degree first. Typically, this comes in the form of a master's degree. If you already have another graduate degree, this one might be off the table. However, it is true that students who are applying to PhD programs and already have master's degrees often are stronger applicants. Most of the time, it's not simply by virtue of having a degree. It's because a master's degree often leaves you with more research experience, experience taking graduate level classes, and therefore faculty who can write you letters of recommendation, speaking to your potential as a graduate student. It can also be really useful because you would get a taste of what it's like to be a graduate student in your field and decide whether it's really what you want or not, and probably be able to speak much more clearly to why you want to get a PhD. You also might even consider looking into whether there are master's programs at the dream school that you did not get into a PhD for. Sometimes it's possible for students who do very well in a master's program to be able to just kind of slip into a PhD program, but of course that is not guaranteed. All this said, I realize that master's degrees can be very expensive and funding for those is less prevalent than they are for PhD programs, so not everyone will be able to take this particular path. So a second option, get work experience, preferably that is relevant to your field. Again, what this looks like is going to be different for everyone, but there are strong PhD applicants all the time, in part because they have a few years or even decades of experience of work in industry, nonprofits, government, labs, etc. In theory, the closer the job is to the kind of experience that's relevant for your field, the better. But this doesn't mean, for example, that if you want to get a PhD in biology, the only relevant work experience is like a research technician in a wet lab. It could also be great to be a science journalist or a middle school science teacher, or to work at an advocacy organization. This is also a nice option because you'd spend a few years making more money than you would as a PhD student, probably. And third, some other path towards research experience. If you are out of school and you can't find a job that is directly research in your field, this can, of course, be more difficult, but it's not impossible, particularly now with so many people doing remote work. Consider reaching out to faculty and PhD students whose work you admire to see if they need an extra pair of hands on a project. Just don't be upset if the answer is no, or you don't get an answer at all. You should also be aware, though, that it can be challenging to hire people outside the university as research assistants, or there might not even be any money available for particular projects. This could mean that you would essentially be volunteering your labor. For this reason, I am hesitant to really strongly recommend this particular path, because not everyone can afford to spend their time on something for which they're not getting paid. That said, if you're able to do it, if you have the time, and of course, if you're wanting to get a PhD, that probably means that you love research, so it's something to consider. Or especially if you're in a humanities discipline where research tends to be quite individual, you could consider writing essays or even blog posts about something that you're passionate about in that field. This shows that you are dedicated, that you're thinking. It could make you a stronger applicant. And of course, it's also possible that your application was great and you have all the experience that you need. On paper, you're amazing, but maybe you didn't apply to the right places or to enough places. So, a fourth suggestion, find more programs to apply to. Now, there isn't a magic number here. I really can't tell you, and how many programs you decide to apply to will also depend on, for example, what you can afford in application fees. And it's going to be different for every field and subfield, how many there are even that are appropriate at all. And we all have dream schools, but you have to consider both fit and odds. Again, back to you could be a wonderful applicant, but that particular program just doesn't have space for new students. This is, of course, an argument for just trying again next year, but also for giving yourself more options. Especially if you're in a lab-based discipline where advisor fit is very important, do more research about who is doing the kind of work that you want to do and what programs they're affiliated with. Don't get too hung up on the prestige of the university. Sometimes there are amazing faculty in programs that are not as competitive. Pay attention to faculty hires in your field. There's people who are going to need more students. Pay attention to grant award announcements in your field. This will suggest what faculty have funding and what kind of work they're going to need students to do. As I talked about in my video about deciding where to apply, the criteria that you should consider is, would I rather go to this program or wait? You shouldn't apply to places where you'd rather not go anywhere at all than go there. So now that you're in this position, a way to think about this might be, if I had applied to this program this year, would I have been happy to get accepted there? Would I have gone? And if so, put them on your list for next year. And finally, you should redo your research for tailoring applications. Because once more for the back of the room, if you are in one of those disciplines where advisor fit is really important, it is entirely possible that the sole reason you were rejected was that there wasn't an advisor fit for you. Now, this could be either because there's not anyone in the department doing the kind of work that you want to do, or it could be that there is, but they can't take on new advisees. So in addition to the things I just mentioned, paying attention to new hires, paying attention to grant announcements, also consider following the faculty that you admire on social media or setting a Google Scholar alert for them so that you know what they're up to and what kind of work they're doing. This isn't stalking. It's fine if you follow someone on Twitter. And then when the time comes, probably early fall, if it's appropriate in your discipline to do this, reach out to these faculty members to find out if they're potentially taking on new advisees during that admission cycle and what kind of work they're currently doing. I'll link below to a Twitter thread where I gave a kind of template for writing this sort of email, and maybe I'll do a video about it when the time comes. But one of the great things about doing this due diligence is both that you can find out what they're currently working on, which you might not know about because if it's their current work, they probably haven't published on it yet. But also, if, for example, they're not taking on new advisees or planning to during that admission cycle, they will likely tell you other faculty in that department that you might want to reach out to. I know that it is very frustrating to not know why you received rejections, but I hope that this video gives you some things to think about, because in sum, my advice is, if you really want this, try again, but don't put your life on hold in the meantime. And for those of you who received acceptances already during this cycle, first of all, congratulations. And also please feel free to put your own advice in the comments below for people who might be deciding to go on this journey again. And once again, I was rejected from every PhD program I applied to the first time around. I spent a year working in my area of expertise as a technical writer. Then I went to law school. Now, I'm not saying you should go to law school if you know you want to get a PhD. To be fair, I thought I wanted to be a lawyer. But it is the case that I got into a PhD program the second time around, even though it was 4 years after the first time that I applied to PhD programs. And also, to be clear, there is no such thing as too old to start a PhD. So don't start thinking that if you get a master's degree or if you have a career for a few years, that you're somehow messing up your whole trajectory. It's totally fine, I promise. In fact, as I said, a lot of the strongest PhD applicants are not coming straight out of undergrad. And again, if you're watching this because you have gotten a pile of rejections and you're feeling dejected, I'm really sorry, but I promise it's not the end of the world. I really do encourage you to keep going. And good luck to all of you. I'm Casey. Thanks for watching.